opening song today is number 229, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. Please stand. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Ye seed of Israel's chosen race, ye ransom of the fall. Hail him who saves you by his grace and crown him Lord of all.
Hail him who saves you by his grace and crown him Lord of all. Let every kindred, every tribe on this terrestrial pole, to him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord of all. To him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord of all. Oh, that with yonder sacred throng we at his feet may fall, join in the everlasting song and crown him Lord of all. Join in the everlasting song and crown him Lord of all.
Amen, and you may be seated.
Good morning. The song I'm going to share with you this morning is one of my favorites, and it is just Psalm 23 put to music. And I think the message that's brought out in it is just very beautiful. So the first time through will be in English, and then the second time through will be in Hebrew.
Shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me by still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Shadow of death, I will fear no evil, prepare a table in the presence of mine enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all my days, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Adonai Rohi. Yavitzeni, ahome menuchot yenaleni, nafshi yeshuvev. Yincheni v'maged letzedek, leman shemo.
It's a pleasure to welcome Emily back. And Emily worked with us for 3.5 or 4 months with our evangelism team. Emily is a faculty member of Souls West Bible College, and she leads missionary groups and evangelism teams. But more than that also, I was surprised to learn that she had taken the summer off for vacation. And I was surprised because I know her work ethics and I know how long and hard she works. And then she honestly opened up and said, well, actually, during the summer, I've been studying the books of Daniel and Revelation because I'm going to be teaching Daniel and Revelation this next year. I would love to sit in on Emily's classes. I'm sure you would as well, but her students will have a rare privilege. I've seen Emily's resume, and it's the longest I've ever seen. She has so many professional experiences and knowledge, and yet she continues to dedicate herself to God and to His work and to leading missionaries and evangelists. We're privileged to have Emily here today, and may God bless you, Emily, as you speak to us.
Thank you. Good morning. Happy Sabbath. While we wait for it, I'll share. Thank you, Pastor, for the warm welcome and introduction. I'll share a little bit about myself because I know I was here for 3 months or so, but I worked a lot with the students. And so I will just share a little bit so you kind of get to know me a little bit better, and then we'll get right into our message. So a little bit about my family. My dad's side of the family is French Huguenot descent. They had to flee France during the Bartholomew Massacre era, and went to England, and that's where they picked up the English form of our last name, Duffield. So then they came to America, and one of my great-great-grandpas actually was a Millerite preacher in the 1840s. You can find his book called Dissertations on the Second Coming of Christ in the Book of Daniel in 2300 Days. You know how they had those long titles back then. He was that, and then later on they became Seventh-day Adventists. And so on my dad's side, it's about six generations back, Seventh-day Adventists. Several of them were ministers. One was a conference president in Wisconsin for a while, and another one was a delegate at the 1888 General Conference. So it was very much a part of Adventism on that side of the family. In fact, my great-grandpa worked for Christian Record Services. He'd help with the printing for the Braille there. And then his son was a printer for many years. He worked at Pacific Press. And so Adventism and literature and all those things is very much ingrained on that side of the family. But it's no less on the other side of the family. My mom's side, they were a Jewish family. They were refugees. They fled from Odessa, Ukraine, just before Hitler came to power. And they settled in South Dakota. And then a colporter, Adventist colporter, knocked on their door and sold them the book, The Great Controversy. And they read it. My great-grandfather read it, and he was convicted by it, began to share it with the family in the community, and they said, "You're going crazy." So they called the police on him, and we're going to ship him off to an insane asylum, which back in those days were not very pleasant places. They got him, and they shipped him off. And unfortunately, on the train ride, he got up to get some luggage down or something, and it ended up falling and breaking his neck, and he passed away. But the impact of that book stayed with the family, and many of them became Adventists. And so then my whole mom's side of the family is Adventist today. And so it's amazing, right? I don't know who that culprit was. It won't be till we get to the kingdom that I'll get to meet him and be one of those people that's like, "Hey, because of your work, my family has had the opportunity to get to know God and Jesus." So that all being said, I grew up in a very, I guess you could say, a very Seventh-day Adventist home, and which was a blessing. And I'm not going to share my whole testimony today. That's we're going to share something else. But grew up reading the Bible. I mean, I would listen to the Bible on audio tape for like fun, for pastime, doing my chores and stuff. Very much always interested in the Bible and God. Started having morning time with God when I was like 2 years old, memorized lots of passages of scripture, and that was a huge blessing in my life. But it wasn't actually until more recently, and I was involved in ministry for the last 10 years or so, full-time ministry in different areas, Bible work, health work, youth evangelism, most recently at Souls West with the literature evangelism. But it wasn't actually until this last winter. Part of that journey started in the fall, and part of that journey actually happened here while I was at Ojai with the team. And God worked in a very deep way in my life, and it was actually that room there was my room that I lived in while we were here, and it was in that room that God really worked deeply in my life because I came to realize that I knew a lot about God, but I didn't know God. on a personal level. And I was a Bible teacher, and I was teaching other young people and sharing the gospel and all these things, but I realized that it was all just knowledge. And God brought me through an experience of really getting to know him for myself. And the last 9 months or so have been some of the best in my life on really having a personal relationship with Jesus. And the Bible isn't just a textbook that you read and dissect like any biology book, but and we do study the Bible, and that's important, but what's beyond that is the God of the Bible that you know. When we get to the kingdom, you know the parable that Jesus tells, right? Those who get to the kingdom and they're like, Lord, haven't we done, you know, all these amazing things? And, you know, for some of us, maybe we haven't healed anyone or cast out demons, but we can put in anything else we've done for the Lord, right? Haven't we knocked on doors? Haven't we given Bible studies? Haven't we done all these amazing things? And his answer to them is, I don't know you. And what he's saying is what's really important, John 17:3, this is eternal life, that they might know God, right? And so it's been that has hugely impacted my life, and it's actually impacted my ministry with young people. When I went back to spring quarter, I was giving lectures and classes, and the students were coming up to me and they said, listen, your classes in the fall were good, but something's different. It's like it's personal. We can tell something happened. And so I praise the Lord for that, that he has really taken it from the head to the heart. And so, but let's go ahead and get into our message this morning. The title is The Face of Jesus. And I'm going to be talking a little bit about this concept of knowing God. But let's go ahead and pray. I'll kneel if you can bow your heads, and then we'll dive in. Father in heaven, Lord, I want to thank you so much for the life that you have given to me and how you've worked in my life and my family's life from generations past. But Lord, as I shared, that it has to become a personal thing, and as you become a personal God to me, here in this church, it is a privilege to be back here and to share with my brothers and sisters today. And Lord, I don't have anything, but we have your word, and that's what matters. And so I pray, Father, that you would speak through me, that the cross of Jesus would shine forth, and that your character would be seen, and that the lies that Satan seeks to tell us all the time will be broken, and that our hearts and minds would be set free and drawn closer to you. And I pray and ask this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. You know, in Scripture, we see a lot of what might have beens. And I was kind of contemplating on the subject a few weeks ago, and that's kind of where this message came from. But there's a lot of what might have beens in Scripture, right? What might have been if the people in Noah's day had listened to his preaching? You know why the boat was so big? It wasn't to fit all the animals. It was to fit the people. What might have been, right? A world completely different. What might have been if the children of Israel had not rebelled against God? They would never have been taken into Babylonian captivity. That whole portion of history would be completely different. What might have been if later on when the Messiah came, if they had accepted him, what might have been? There's actually a passage in the book Desire of Ages that talks about that concept of what Israel might have been if she had accepted Jesus as her Messiah. And it's a powerful concept. And that's what Jesus was talking about. When he wept over Jerusalem, he said, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets, oh, that you had known the things that belong to your peace, but now they are hid from your eyes, right? If you had known what might have been, if you had but accepted me. And but the first what might have been that we see in Scripture is found in Genesis chapter 3. What might have been if Adam and Eve had not taken the fruit? Our world would be completely different. Completely different. So we're going to go to that. We're going to go to that story. We're not going to read the whole story, but we're going to go to that story, and we're going to take out a few principles that we see in it. So turn with me in your Bibles to Genesis chapter 3. And you're all familiar with the story in Genesis chapter 3, right? The serpent comes to Adam and Eve and presents to them this proposition, right? And in Genesis chapter 3, 1 through 6 is pretty much that whole interaction, right? And in that passage, we see that Satan actually gives three different lies to Eve. And we're going to break these down one by one. So let's go ahead and look at verse 1, right? Now the serpent was more wise than any other creature which the Lord God had created. And he said to the woman, "Did God really say, you cannot eat from all the trees of the garden?" So he comes to them and he asks this question, "Did God really say that they cannot eat from all the trees of the garden?" Question. Was that technically correct? Could they actually eat from every single last tree in the garden? No, right? Why? Right? So there was one tree they couldn't eat from, so technically speaking, they couldn't eat from all, right? Because it's all but one. So what Satan's saying here is actually technically correct. Did God really say, you can't eat from all the trees? Well, that's technically true. So then what's the problem with what he's saying? It's what he's implying that's the problem. Let me illustrate it this way. Suppose we went somewhere where someone had, let's say we go downtown Ojai here, right? And we go into one of the restaurants there and they've turned it into a buffet, right? And this is like buffet of all buffets, where there is just thousands of different varieties of fruit, like top-notch, amazing taste. It's all like vegetarian and amazing, right? And so we go in there, right? And the owner of this new buffet restaurant tells you, "Hey, we're opening this up for the community. We just want to help the community out. So all of this food is free to the taking. You can have as much as you want, whenever you want it. And we change the menu every week, so it constantly changes. And you'll never run out of new stuff to eat. And you can come anytime you want and eat whatever you want." There's only one thing, and that there's a bin over there, one of in the line, the one that's very much marked. Don't eat that one because that one has poison in it, and if you eat it, you will die. If we had that situation happen to us, and would we go to our friends and neighbors and say, "You know, today I met the most stingy, ungenerous guy I've ever met in my entire life"? No, we wouldn't, right? We would say, "Today I met the most generous, kind guy I've ever met. He said I could eat everything," right? We might mention, "Hey, there's the one box, don't eat it because you'll die if you do." But we wouldn't focus on that because there's so much else we could have. What Satan is implying with his statement is focusing on the one box that would harm them and saying God's not generous because he's trying to protect you from the one thing that's going to harm you, but he's giving you everything else. You see how that is, right? So his question is technically correct, but it's what he's implying that is incorrect. And so this is where we see lie number one, that Satan claims that God is not generous. So lie number one is what? God is not generous. Good. All right, let's go to the next verse where we see the next lie. We see this found in, because Eve, obviously in verse 2 and 3, gives her answer, right? And then we see in verse 4, the Bible says, "The serpent then said to the woman, you shall not surely die." So his second statement is, "You will not die." What had God said? You will die. If you eat it, you will die. What does it say? What does Satan say? You're not going to die. So what is Satan calling God? A liar. Right? So he's saying, God said you won't die, but I'm saying you... God said you will die, but I'm saying you won't die. Therefore, God is not telling you the truth. So line number one, God is not generous. Line number two, God is a liar. And then we see in verse 5, lie number 3. For God knows that in the day you eat thereof, your eyes shall be open, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And this is another one that where he's what he's implying as well, right? So he's saying, listen. God said you were going to die. But in actuality, you're not going to die. And in fact, it's not just that you're not going to die, but if you eat this fruit, you're going to gain this whole experience that's going to be way beyond anything you've ever known, because you're going to actually become like God. You're going to become a God. In other words, God, and God knows this. God knows that if you eat this, you're going to become like become a God. So therefore, he's trying to keep it from you, because he doesn't want you to become like him. He wants to keep you suppressed and down in your realm, and he knows all these things, so he's keeping all this information from you, and he's telling you these lies that if you eat it, you're going to die. So in other words, God is selfish. He doesn't have your best interest in mind, and he's trying to keep something that's actually for your good interest from you. So here we see the three lies that Satan gives. Number one, God is not generous. Number two, God is a liar. And number three, God is selfish. But if we look through the rest of Scripture, we don't have time to do this, but you can write these texts down. In 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 17, 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 17, and James chapter 1, verse 5, the Bible very clearly, and these are just a couple passages that you can read this elsewhere, very clearly gives that God is generous, that he gives and gives. And then we see in Numbers 23:19, in Hebrews 6:18, there's a few other passages that bring this out as well, that God cannot lie. God is not a man that he should lie, right? In Hebrews, it's impossible for him to lie, it says. And then, of course, in 1 John 4:8 and 1 Corinthians 13:5, we see this idea that God is unselfish and he is love. He is unselfish love, right? So what we see in Scripture is very completely opposite to what Satan in the garden gives to Eve, right? The complete opposite. God is not generous. No, actually, God is generous. God is a liar. No, actually, God cannot lie. God is selfish. No, actually, God is unselfish love. But if we read, continue reading in the passage in Genesis chapter 3, what happens? She believes a lie, and she takes the fruit. She believes the lie, and she takes the fruit. Now, what happens immediately after? Let's look at verse 8. Genesis chapter 3 and verse 8. And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and the man and his wife hid themselves in the leaves of the tree of the garden. Right? So they run and hide. And if we jump down to verse, right, God comes and says, where are you? Verse 10, Adam responds. What does he say? I was afraid. Why did he hide? He was afraid. He says, I hid because I was afraid. Afraid of who? God. I was afraid of you. If you look at chapter 1 and chapter 2, you don't see this picture at all, right? You see man in Adam and Eve in communion with God, right? And God is talking to them and he's giving them commands. And they're not running and hiding. They're there, right? And there's this idea, and God says it's good, 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 very good. Everything about creation was good. There was no shame, it says. And then here in chapter 3, verse 10, we all of a sudden see this switch. where man now runs and hides from his own creator because he's afraid. And then in verse 12 and 13, when God asks them, you know, more further questions, they begin blaming each other and really actually blaming God, right? The woman you made, the serpent you made, right? They're blaming God. What happened, right? What happened? All of a sudden, they become afraid of God because they believed the lies that had been told. That's why they were afraid, was because they believed that God was actually not generous. They believed that God was a liar, and they believed that God was selfish. And because they believed this lie, all they now thought about was self-preservation. Because think about it. If the God who created you, who's all-powerful, you suddenly come to realize that he's an ungenerous, lying, selfish tyrant, who are you going to be worried about? Yourself, right? Your own preservation. And that's why then when God comes and starts asking them questions, rather than owning up to their own sin, they start blaming each other. Because all they're thinking about is their own preservation. And then they blame God, right? It's your fault. And so then we see Romans 5 talks about this. Romans 5:12, sin entered into the world, right? And death by sin. And so we see this experience that all of God's creation enters into. Now, what, according to Scripture, what is sin? The transgression of the law, right? 1 John 3:4. That sin is the transgression of the law. Now, I don't have time to go into all the Scriptures. You can do this study on your own time. But we see throughout Scripture that the law of God is simply a written out version of his own character. Right? And the Bible says in 1 John 4:8 that God is love. Therefore, the commandment, if it's simply a writing out inscription of what God is like, his character, then the law is an embodiment of what love looks like. Right? And why did God have to give it written on Mount Sinai? Because we had gotten so confused by sin that we didn't even know what love was supposed to look like. So he says, let me explain it to you. Put it in writing. This principle of love that has been existent all before, right? God's law was already always there because God has always been. His character's always been. So, but he had to write it down to help humanity understand this is what love looks like. You don't go killing people. You don't go cheating on people. You don't go lying. You don't go hating on God and spending all of your time on yourself. A person who has the love of God in their heart is not going to live that way. This is what love looks like. Now, I want you to imagine, it's hard for us to imagine this, but I want you to imagine one of the most dangerous cities in the world. Going downtown that city in the middle of the night, unarmed, by yourself, and feeling 100% completely safe. It's kind of like mind-blowing for us, right? Or imagine going in the middle of like the deepest, thickest jungle. There's lions and tigers and spiders and snakes and all this stuff. And you feel completely safe. Because everything in creation is working on this principle of unselfish love. No one's going to hurt anybody else. That's what the world was supposed to look like. That's what life is supposed to look like. And yet it doesn't, right? So many times we have, our world is filled with so much craziness, pain, suffering, genocide, hatred, right? Murder, killing, stealing, confusion. Why? Because everybody is naturally we are now operating on this principle of selfishness, self-preservation. And so all we think about is saving ourselves. And if you're only interested in saving yourself, then you see something else that someone else has, right, that you think you might need, and you want it. Commandment number 10, right? You covet it. Then they don't want to give it to you because they want it. So then you try to take it by force, stealing. And then they get mad that you took it because they thought they needed it. And then they hate you and they kill you, right? Murder. Or you see someone's wife or whatever, right? It can go down the line. And then you have to lie to cover it all up. We see this in the story of David, right, with Bathsheba. He saw something that he wanted that wasn't his. He coveted it. And then he took it. And then he had to lie and murder to cover it all up. But what is all of this idea of self-preservation stemming from? Where did it start in the Garden of Eden? When did this principle come in? Exactly, right? They believed the lie that Satan told. And when they believed the lie about the character of God and realized or thought that God was selfish, ungenerous, a lying tyrant, it changed something in the mind that now became self-preservation as the core of us. And sin, eventually, according to James 1, 5, what does sin do? Eventually, it kills. Sin kills. And that is why God hates it so much. Because it causes so much chaos, pain, suffering in our world, right? And we're all his children. So all of this happens in creation, right? And what does God find himself? He finds himself in this very unique situation. Turn with me in your Bibles to Romans chapter 7. We're going to see 3 points about what God thinks about things, and then we're going to tie it together. So Romans chapter 7. And if we look at verse 14, it says, now we know, in effect, that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, what? Sold under sin. Okay, so sin is taking us bondage. Now jump down to verse 20. Where does it say, according to verse 20, where does it say sin dwells? In me, right? Sin dwells in us. So according to Scripture, where does sin dwell? In us, right? Okay, so hold that thought. Now we're going to go to the second thought. In Psalms 5 and Proverbs 8, we see where God talks about how he hates sin and evil, right? And we just talked about why, right? Why does God hate evil? Because it causes so much pain and suffering, and it kills, and it causes destruction, right? So God hates sin. Now turn with me to Jeremiah chapter 31. Jeremiah chapter 31. And we're going to look at verse 3. Jeremiah 31, 3. But the Lord spoke unto me of old, saying, I have loved you with a everlasting love, therefore with loving kindness have I drawn you. So, where does sin dwell? In us. How does God view sin? He hates it, right? He hates sin. But how does he view us? He loves us with an everlasting love. So God finds himself in this unique situation where the thing he hates the most, sin, is dwelling deep inside the ones he loves the most. So what's going to happen? If he destroys sin, who is he also going to destroy? Us. But if he doesn't destroy sin, what is sin going to do? It's going to destroy us. So it's like a rock and a hard place, right? What do you do? God has to somehow remove the sin from us so he can now destroy it without destroying us. But we saw in Genesis 3, what is the foundation of sin? Where did it start? With a misunderstanding of the character of God. That's where it started. They believed the lie about God, and they ate the fruit, and self-preservation became their only goal. That's where sin started for humanity, right? So if the foundation of it is a misunderstanding of the character of God, then what would be the solution? A correct understanding of the character of God. But then we have another problem. If God were to just show up here and say, hey, I'm God, I'm really actually not what the devil says I am, we would be either one, destroyed by his glory, right? Because we're full of sin. Or number two, we would be so scared, like Adam and Eve, we'd run and hide, we'd give it, would never give him a chance to actually explain himself. So what does God have to do? He has to become one of us so that he doesn't destroy us by his glory and he doesn't scare us because he looks just like us. And then he can live a life that explains and expresses what God is really like. And that's where we then come to John chapter 3:16, right? For God so loved the world that he gave his son so that whoever believes in him does not have to perish but can have everlasting life. Turn with me to John, 1 John chapter 5. Why did Jesus come? Why did Jesus come? To give us an understanding, right? Tess is on it. In 1 John chapter 5, right? There's many reasons Jesus came to be our sacrifice, to live a life, right? But we could sum it all up in what 1 John chapter 5 says. So you turn there with me to 1 John chapter 5. And look at verse 20. 1 John chapter 5 and verse 20. But we know that the Son of God has come and has given us an understanding that we might know him that is true, and we are in him that is true, in the Son Jesus Christ. This is the true God, and this is eternal life. Let's break it down, because it's kind of a long, complex sentence right here. But in 1 John 5:20, he's saying, we know that Jesus came to give us what? An understanding so that we could know God. And the rest of the passage is describing what we're going to know, right? The truth, God, his son, right? And this is the true God and eternal life. So again, we have this idea of knowing God and eternal life tied in, right? And if we go to John 17:3, the Bible says, this is eternal life, that they might know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. Eternal life is knowing God. Amen. Eternal life is knowing God. And according to 1 John 5:20, the reason why Jesus came, if we sum it all up in one reason, it was to show us what God is actually like. To show us who God is, so that we can know him, and by knowing him, we can have eternal life. And this is why when Jesus was on earth and he was preaching, he said, if you've seen me, you've seen who?
Father.
The Father. Because I'm simply a reflection of what God is like. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. So how does this become practical to us? Let's go to our scripture reading from this morning. 2 Corinthians chapter 3. 2 Corinthians chapter 3. And we're going to read verse 18. And the Bible says in verse 18, "But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord." So let's break this text down. We all, with what kind of face? An open face. Beholding as in a glass. So what are we doing? We're beholding, right? As if we were looking in a mirror. And what are we looking at? The glory of the Lord. Okay, so we're beholding the glory of the Lord with an open face, as if we were looking in a mirror, right? We're beholding the glory of God. And what is the promise? What's going to happen? We're changed into the same image from glory to glory. And who does the work? The Spirit of the Lord works, right? So as we behold, here's the promise, as we behold the glory of God, we are going to be changed into the same image, and it's a process because it says from glory to glory, as the Spirit works upon the heart. Now here's the question, where do we see the glory of God? We're going to jump down just a few verses, right, in the context. What is Paul talking about? He goes on in chapter 4, verse 3 and 4, he talks about how people's minds have been blinded by the god of this world. So what's been blinded? Their minds, right? He's blinded the minds of people, right? We see this all the way from creation. He blinded Adam and Eve's mind so that they saw God in a different light than who he really was. So this is what Satan's goal is, right? To blind the minds so that, in verse 4, the god of this world has blinded the minds so that the glorious gospel, right, of the glory of God, which is the image of God, should shine in their hearts, right? And then if we jump down to verse 6, he continues and he said, "For God, the God who said, 'Let the light shine out of darkness.'" What is Paul referring to? What event in history? Creation, when God said, "Let there be light," and there was God, and then there was light. So he's saying the same God who said, "Let there be light," continues, has done what? Has shone in our hearts so that the knowledge of the glory of God could be seen in the face of Jesus. So where do we see the glory of God? In the face of Jesus. So let's take that idea and let's plug it back into chapter 3, verse 18. We all, with open face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of God in the face of Jesus, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. What the text is saying is if we behold Jesus, the Spirit of God is going to work in the heart and is going to change the heart into the same image so that we won't operate on this principle of self-preservation, because we're going to get a new picture of the character of God and we're going to realize God is actually generous. God is actually truth. He doesn't tell lies. God is actually loving, unselfish love. And as we see that picture, it has an impact on the heart and the mind, and it changes us from the inside out. And then we realize we cease to do all those things we used to do out of self-preservation. We don't need to hate other people anymore. We don't need to kill. We don't need to steal. We don't need to, right? Any of these things we don't need to do anymore because the love of God is in our heart, and the Ten Commandments are simply what love looks like. If God's love is in your heart, that's what your life's going to look like. And the promise is that God is going to change the heart. And what is our part? To simply behold the glory of God in the face of Jesus. As we behold Jesus, we change. It's the same principle as in Proverbs, right? As a man thinks in his heart, so he is. The gospel has the power to change the life as we think about it and behold it. And it's not just sitting down and reading scripture as a textbook to dissect and get ideas and thoughts of how we can, you know, prove our point or whatever. It's a book that's supposed to show us what God is like and what a life with the love of God in the heart looks like. And as we take the time, as we read scripture and let the mind contemplate it, actually think about it, behold Jesus, let your mind see it. The promise is that we're going to get changed. Our hearts are going to be changed from being one of selfishness to one of unselfish love. But here's the question. As we begin to wrap up, here's the question. We saw in 1 John chapter 5 that God sent Jesus to show us what God is like, right? He sent Jesus to show us what God is like. So here was the big question. Since Satan started telling his lies about God, the big question was, is God actually who he says he is? Because you have his word against his word, right? Satan says, well, you're a liar. God says, no, I tell the truth. Satan says, you're ungenerous. No, I am generous. Satan says, you're selfish. No, I'm unselfish love. Who's right, right? You have to actually prove it. And when Jesus came to this world, his mission was to show us humanity, but also show the universe and all the unfallen angels what God is actually like. So I want to end with a story. It's a story that many of us are very familiar with, but I think it would do well for us to think about it more often. I want you to imagine Jesus in heaven. He's been there from eternity past with God. He is God. And he's in this unselfish, loving, right? God, the whole Godhead is in, they're all love. And they unselfishly love each other. And then they create the angels and they create the other worlds so that they can love more. And everybody is operating on this principle of unselfish love to one another. But then our little world gets into a pickle, right? And we have this misunderstanding of the character of God. And so as we talked about earlier, right, Jesus has to come and become one of us. And so he comes down. And he doesn't just show up as a grown man. He starts in a womb. And then he's born as a baby. In a barn. He grows up as a peasant. He has to work with his family for their own food. And everybody, now he's living in a completely different world where everybody around him is operating on this principle of selfishness. Talk about culture shock. Completely different. And his mission, he knows his mission. From the time he's 12 years old in the sanctuary, he visits, right? And he sees that sacrifice for this first time, and the Spirit of God is working on his heart, and he realizes that's me. That's my life mission. That's why I'm here. And as he begins his ministry, well, even before he began his ministry, his family didn't understand him. They thought he was crazy. But then as he begins his ministry, it becomes even more. Everybody around him for 3.5 years in his public ministry don't understand him. Even his closest friends, the disciples, don't even understand his full mission. And there's different times when they try to stop him to do stuff. Like, don't go there. And the religious leaders of his day hate him. They think he's a fraud. They make all kinds of stories about him. And throughout all those years, Satan's on his track because he's trying to disrupt this whole plan. He's trying to get Jesus to somehow be selfish so he can prove that God is actually not who he says he is. But he keeps going. And he keeps going because his whole life is centered on this one mission, which is to show the world what God is really like. And so he keeps going, but no one seems to get it. And finally, it gets so bad that some of one of his closest friends turns him over to the authorities. And the another of his closest friends says, I don't even know who that guy is. And so they take him, the authorities take him, right? They take him before Annas and Caiaphas, a farce of a trial. I mean, there was no manner of justice in this thing. And he goes through every kind of abuse possible, right? As that evening and that night and the next day goes through, we don't understand what Jesus went through. He was beaten and spat and mocked, his beard pulled out, laughed at, abused. Crowned with thorns, scourged twice. No water, no food, no comfort. Everybody around him is trying to tell him he's not who he is. And he still keeps going. As Isaiah said, as a lamb led to a slaughter, so he did not open his mouth. I don't know, have any of you been around sheep? They're some of the most docile creatures, right? They're not the smartest things out there, which is I think why God sometimes refers us to as them, but they'll just follow a leader off a cliff, you know, if one sheep goes through a chute and you put a stick up, the first one will jump, you put the stick down, every other sheep will jump in that exact same spot because the one in front of them jumped. But another thing with the sheep is that if they fall and they get their feet a little higher than their head, they can't get back up. But like what most other creatures out there would struggle and cry and try to get up, right? A sheep will literally just lie there and die. If a wild animal comes, tries to attack it, they'll just stand there where the animal bites its throat, which is why they need a shepherd to take care of them, because they're such needy creatures. But Jesus is likened to a lamb in that when he went through all of this, he didn't fight it. As he says, no one's taking my life from me. I'm willingly laying it down. And finally, he's taken and he's hung on a tree. And 6 hours later, he dies. Now, if you know history, most crucifixion victims took 2 or 3 days to die. He died in 6 hours. Why? It wasn't the cross that killed him. When Jesus goes into Gethsemane, there's two statements he makes. The first one is as he's going in, he tells his disciples, he says, my soul is sorrowful even unto death. And when you study this concept in Scripture, whenever the soul and death are mentioned, it's the experience of hell. Jesus is saying, my soul is dying. I am going through the experience of hell. And we see in other passages why, because the sins of the world were placed upon him. 2 Corinthians 5:21, he became sin itself for us. So he's going through this experience, and because of that experience, the second thing happens, which he says to his disciples when he's going into the garden, you're going to get offended and you're going to run away, but that's okay because my Father is always with me. He's never left me. He makes this statement as he's going into Gethsemane, this statement of sure truth. My Father's never left me. It's okay if you do because he's always there for me. And yet about a day and a half later, we see him hanging on the cross and he cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me? My Father, where are you? Why did you abandon me? Because as he was taking the weight of the sin of the world on him, the separation between his Father and him happened. and it broke his heart. He literally died of a broken heart. And that's why he died in 6 hours. But how does this all have to do with everything? Jesus' whole mission in life was to show what God was like. And I just want, I want you to imagine, like, imagine with me standing on Golgotha. And they brought Jesus up there to the hill. And he's standing there, bruised, beaten, bleeding. And on the ground is lying a cross with the nails ready. And everybody around, his disciples, they think that Jesus is the Messiah, right? And they believe that as the Messiah, he's going to conquer the Romans. They have this other idea, right? So they're standing there with bated breath, waiting for him to somehow show his power and stop this whole thing. So you can imagine the disciples standing there waiting. Like, when is he going to, when is he going to heal himself? He's the great healer. And then beyond the physical world, we have the supernatural world of all the angels and Satan. Satan's claim from all history was that God was selfish. And he gets to this point, and it seems like evil's about to prevail, and Satan's making the claim he's not going to do it. He's not going to go through with it. He's not going to die. And the angels are waiting. Is he going to call us to come? Is he going to heal himself and walk away? Because he could do that. Because it wasn't his fault. It was our problem. And evil and Satan is declaring God is selfish. He's not going to do it. And you can imagine with amazement as they saw him lay down, stretch out his arms, and submit himself to the death that we deserve. And by that act, he was writing a message of a very different kind. That God is who he says he is. That God would rather cease to exist. Because you know he couldn't see through the tomb. He thought he was going to cease to exist. But he would rather do that than for you and I to not have eternal life with his Father. And by that, he declared, this is what God is like. And that is why, as we see the glory of God in the face of Jesus, we see a very different picture, and we can be changed into the same. All of us, to some degree, because we were born in this world, have had a misunderstanding of the character of God. And that may be from life circumstances, from parents, from Satan himself, you know, suggesting thoughts and ideas to us, what other people around us have said. But all of us have experienced to some extent a misunderstanding of the character of God. But the reason Jesus came was to change that and to show us a different picture of who God was, so that by that understanding, we can have a God that we can rest in his love, and we don't have to try to save ourselves. Right. Yeah. And self-preservation and selfishness. Yeah. We can let him take care of us. Yes. We can let him love us. Amen. And we can let him change us so that we can love the people around us. Yeah. But it takes time to undo the lies. And that's why it says from glory to glory, right? So what is our part? To daily behold Jesus. And let that change us. Amen? How many of you want to allow God to change your heart and to daily say, Lord, I want to behold Jesus so that I can get a different picture of who God is? Amen? I want you to think about that as you listen to the words of this song. I can see her laying there. Everyone around her stared. They were gonna stone her, no one even cared. The law condemned the sin she had been caught in. It was a rule they knew that Jesus wouldn't stand against. Down, they didn't stand a chance. They stood amazed as he knelt down with his finger to the ground. He wrote a message of a different kind. Heads were hanging all around as their stones fell to the ground. Her sin was clear, but fault he did not find. He wrote a message of grace across the sands of time. See him standing there, a wooden cross and some rusty nails. It seemed that evil would at last prevail. Would angels come to rescue God's only son? Would he just heal himself and walk away? This is not a price that he should have to pay. They stood amazed as he lay down, and with his arms stretched open wide, he wrote a message of a different kind. Heads were hanging all around as his own blood poured to the ground. He had no sin, he died for yours and mine. He wrote a message of grace across the sands of time. Stood amazed as he laid down with his arms stretched open wide. He wrote a message of a different kind. Heads were hanging all around as his own blood poured to the ground. He had no sin, he died for yours and mine. Thank you.
message of a different kind.
Please bow your heads with me as we pray. Father, we are filled with complete awe that the King of the universe, the one who created everything, in an effort to show his creation what he is really like, and to undo the lies that Satan has told us, that you would choose to come down to this world to give yourself for us, something you didn't have to do, and that you would willingly give your life to show us what you're really like. My Father, I pray that this verse that we read in 2 Corinthians 3:18 would become a reality in each one of our lives. That daily we would take time to behold the glory of God in the face of Jesus. And that your Spirit would move and work in our hearts to change us into the same image. Father, this is our prayer. And we know you will do it because you promised. And we ask it in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Till we